I started my sophomore year off at Emerson's film program, taking classes in filmmaking, editing, and photography. I even took a class in public speaking. But then 3 weeks in, I got a life-changing call from Atlanta. You're going on tour with blink-182 as a documentary filmmaker. It's my all-time favorite band. What happened next was out of my wildest dreams. We started off our time with blink-182 in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Before Blink got there, we got to check out the city and check out the venue. Pretty weird being on the other side of it, looking out at all the seats and the whole venue. Never thought I'd be here. New Mexico! On the first day, I was really nervous to get up close to Mark, Tom, and Travis and film them play. I didn't want to come into the whole tour as a fan who wanted an autograph. I wanted to come in with a camera to tell a story. But Sarah dragged me on stage and said, just start shooting.
Showtime, 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 showtime.
Everyone welcomed us and made us a part of the tour family. Meg and John definitely set the psychological tone for the whole crew.
You're all good. All right, here we go, guys. Loaders!
John Lafferty, production manager for Blink.
First truck!
I'm responsible for getting the show up and down, moving it from city to city along with my entire crew. A lot of people call me coach because it's a team effort. Everybody helps everybody. Every day is a challenge. Not one single day is the same. Everything changes from venue to venue, day to day. It's just a challenge of making it work. And sometimes the easiest situations and sometimes the worst. It's either I create a vibe or I just have enough good people around me to create a good vibe. Between myself and Meg, my production coordinator, keeping a easy family vibe.
Yeah. Is that okay with you over there?
He's up, he's in the front lounge. He knows he's gonna situation. Be living up there. Copy.
Yes. Happy birthday, mister.
I'm Meg Dieter, and I'm the production coordinator for Blink-182.
Thank you.
It's your birthday?
It is.
Every day is a new place, but that's like, you know, we know what we're doing every day, so the biggest thing, I guess, is that's gonna go to Travis's room, but it can just go right outside up there. The biggest thing is for our job is just adapting to the new place. I'm kind of a mama in a sense too, so if any of my boys are, you know, they don't feel good or I can tell that something's wrong, like everyone cares about everyone. Hi, Mr. Hoppus.
Have you seen these?
No. Wait, what happened to your fingernails? Can I ask that question first?
I painted my nails last night, I don't know. It's a solo cup.
Uh-huh.
You peel this thing off.
And you can write on it.
I want all of these.
Okay. It took a little while when I first started touring. No one understood. Like, when I got home from tour, I slept for a week and my mom would call me, Meg, what's wrong? What's wrong? It's like, Mama, I just worked 18 hours for 2 months. I'm just tired. I need to sleep. I'll call you in a week, you know? But it's really important if you do have someone at home that they have to understand. Because if they don't, things can dissolve really, really quickly. Welcome.
Cool, thank you.
All right, cool. Are you ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, let's do it.
The on-tour lifestyle can be very hard, both physically and emotionally.
This is our bus, our home.
Nice.
For the past 2.5 months.
It's an intense experience of 85 people living and working together and dealing with the good and bad that comes with tour life.
We have I think, 3 or 4 bunks available so that you guys can pick and choose.
How many people are, like, living here?
We have, right now we have, I think, 8 people. We have 12 bunks, but 8 people live on the bus right now, and it's pretty much the sponsor bus.
You guys all fit on this?
Yeah, we make it work.
When you're living on a tour bus day after day with as many as 12 people, it can get tough. There's limited space, long drives, and a lot of different personalities to contend with. But these guys wouldn't have it any other way.
My name's Kyle Havronik. I've been driving a bus 4 years now. When you're on a bus pretty much 24/7, you have to have a little bit of companionship or be able to work with each other and have a good time. For all of us out here, you know, it's a decision that we make, being away from home.
If I was to ever consider going on tour, I would have to have a really steady life at home, because once you leave a tour, you leave for good. You need to be comfortable with where you came from and know that you're going to leave a lot of people behind along the way.
I'm remarried now, and I don't see my wife that much, but we have to trust each other.
The day where I woke up and I knew I was going to be meeting Mark and Tom, I was really excited, and I couldn't really believe it either. I would have never thought that I'd be doing this. As a band, these guys are totally irreverent and immature. But when you get to know them one-on-one, you get a whole new perspective on it. Mark is actually a deep and thoughtful guy.
I wake up every day confident in the knowledge that I will never, ever write anything good ever again. I will try this idea and just hope to God that something cool happens with it. Then I'll add things and other people will add things and the song will kind of develop and I will think that there's no way I'm going to be able to write lyrics for this. And over the course of time I'll write things and sing it and the song will be completed. And then we put the whole album together and I'm like, we put a whole record together. We have 14 songs that are really good, I think. I don't know.
I think they feel they want to come out and be a band and not just like a nostalgia thing where they're going to play their hits. They want to come out and still stay with the times and everything.
I think in Blink, in the beginning, we just wanted to play as fast, as loud, and as catchy as we could.
At first, they came out kind of poppy, kind of trendy. I was like, damn, what, Blink? And after I listened to a couple CDs, I was like, damn, what?
They didn't come out poppy and trendy. They came out awesome.
I think that now we still have that same mentality, but I think we let songs develop a little more. We don't consider ourselves a pop punk band at all. We just consider ourselves a rock band. And whatever we want to do, we're going to try.
It's pretty cool just hearing them change, progress, and then come back together with their progressions. It's been really awesome. They've changed my life, changed my perception on music, so I dedicate a part of my body to them.
Tom is an incredibly savvy businessman.
This tour that we're doing is a giant step forward. This is the first showcase of where our band is going in the future and how we're going to present it. It's really exciting to see the band doing stuff like this because it's so dramatically different than what we did in the past. Although, I must say, we have the same jokes about genitals and bodily functions, but we do it with lasers now. The band's getting along better than we ever have. The band's bigger than it's ever been. I think we're more excited about our music, you know, than we've ever been. So in a lot of ways, it's the most fun it's ever been.
I still like them today because they've stayed true to themselves, but grown sufficiently so that it doesn't seem contrived.
I think Blink is like, it's like eternal youth, you know?
What's your guys' favorite song album?
Adam!
What's my age again?
Adam's song!
Oh my god, totally high five!
What's
my age again?
What is it?
What's my age again?
Either What's My Age Again or First Date, those two. Okay, first CD, I'm gonna go with Buddha Carousel. What's up? Take it back old school.
Everyone always used to always ask us, when are you gonna grow up? When are you gonna grow up? When are you gonna grow up? Every album, every review, every critic, you know. But the funny thing is now that our fans are like at those magazines, they're like, don't grow up, you know, stay young.
I don't know if I'll always follow Blink-182, but Blink-182 will always follow me. Yeah. You know, that music that I listen to will always follow me, and I always check out their new stuff. I don't know if I'll necessarily be into it. Maybe I will, maybe I won't, but their music that they've performed and will perform today, it will always have a place in my heart.
I think what happened is everyone really realized what we were, And now they understand it, and now they embrace it.
I love Travis Barker. He's the sexiest, skinniest guy I've ever seen.
Justin, and I'm a project manager for SGPS Show Rig. I do the drum gag, and you know, I built it in our shop, and I put it together every morning, me and a couple guys and some stagehands, make sure it's safe. The concept came from Travis and Daniel, and the show designer said that we want to build a big stupid arm that flies out over the crowd. And then Eric Pierce is the owner, primary owner of Show Rig, and he takes it from their concept to a conceptual drawing, and then into the build drawings. From there it goes to CNC machines and individual parts come out, weld it all together and bolt it all together, and here we are. The thing's 9,000 pounds, so, and it all hangs in a little centralized area above the turret. There's been a few venues that we couldn't do it. We are in San Diego. The weather's generally pretty calm. It's basically a hometown show for the boys, so. And do what we can to get it done here. This is the third drum gag I built for Travis, and I'm here because he won't fly in anything unless I'm here. For some reason, he trusts me. The kids loved it. They screamed every night, so we've been a lot of work and a lot of engineering and a lot of maintenance that goes into it, but it's still, you know, a 9,000 pound, 59 foot arm that swings out over the crowd with my friend Travis on it. It honestly scares the hell out of me every night.
I wasn't a Blink fan before this tour, and now I'm completely changed. The show is absolutely amazing. I stand on stage every day and I watch the kids and I watch the way they interact, and I am very fortunate and proud and happy to be a part of it.
What do they mean to me? They're my everything. When people walk down the street, they actually know that they might not know my name, but they know I'm a Blink-182 fan.
One of the things I had to face was how to get noticed without being annoying and not being hidden either. It takes a lot of courage to be a filmmaker. You need to know where to push and where to pull back. At that show, I was filming their set, and Mark kind of came across the stage with the camera, and he was like, "What's up, Mike?" I kept filming, but I realized, I was like, wow. These guys who I used to listen to and I only used to know from a distance, I finally broke the barrier down, and I was filming them, and they were interacting with me on camera, and it was a feeling I never thought I'd get. The kids are in a hurry. I'm just full of fear. The lights make bodies blurry. It's getting hard enough to hear. It's like the evidence is cared for.
Tony Robinson, venue security director.
Tony was one of the coolest guys on tour. Not only that, but he has one of the most badass jobs on tour. He keeps the band safe, and he also keeps the fans in line.
The fun part of my job is meeting great people. I just like being around people that know what they're doing, and you know, I'm just a people person.
From day one, he was nothing but helpful to all of us. In Albuquerque, he got us right behind the barricade, right in front of the stage, so we could start filming right away.
More kids are coming over and doing all the moshing and the slam dancing and all the crazy stuff like that. Our crowd was getting more liver. You know, the guys, as they get older, the crowds seem like they're getting younger. I've seen them in the past when it's like, hey guys, you gotta, you know, keep away a certain distance. Now they know their fans is what make them. They feel that fan relationship between artist and fan. Eventually one day, I'm gonna have to hang it up, but as of right now, I'm loving every day of it.
Every show is different. It's a strange chemistry of our performance between the three of us and the reaction of the crowd and our interaction with the crowd. And although we have the same set list every night, every show you walk out and you have no idea what's going to happen.
Robert Ortiz, bass tech for Mark Hoppus. I've been in
punk rock bands here and there and played music and DJed and just messed with gear. From there, it became a job. It's kind of like the kid who ran away and joined the circus, and I stayed. But usually you kind of have to be a little bit in sync with your guide. So if the bass isn't sounding right, I kind of pick up on it because I know what he wants it to sound like. He'll look to me and I'll be like, yes, no, like, you're okay, you're fine, and or I need this or I need that. It's the old joke that road guys, for every 3 years out, we mature 1 year mentally. But it's the opposite physically. We beat the crap out of ourselves physically, traveling constantly, and it takes, you know, its toll on you.
I'm Doug Reisch. I'm the guitar tech for Tom. When I came in the first guitar job I got, the guy's like, hey, what do you know about guitars? And I went, hey, there's one. We start at the beginning of the tour figuring out exactly the sounds we want. And then from then on, it's almost more maintenance than everything else. It's just making sure that it's completely consistent daily. The trick is to make his model guitar and the gear we're traveling with sound as close to the album as possible. It's kind of like traveling in a big giant plastic bubble. It's like the best circus or carnival you can be a part of. But I'm always still nervous before every show or going into it, which I hope I'm always nervous before every show, because if you're not, then you're way too complacent, and that's when bad things happen. There's no rock stars, no ego. There's nobody you can't look into the eye or just like, oh my God, it's the band member, clear the area. I mean, none of that.
Do you do this every night?
Sure. You have to. I mean, I remember being that kid out there wishing I had a guitar pick.
Daniel Jensen and I am Travis's drum tech. I have 4 drum kits, so my day consists of a lot of building drum kits and then taking them down, so mostly it's a lot of maintaining, fixing, building, cleaning of all the drums. I build drums also, so we obviously build Travis all kinds of crazy stuff. It's fun to get together and come up with crazy ideas and make them happen. I love drums and I love the people I work with. Not often you get to work and actually love what you do and like the people you actually do it with.
There were a lot of what the crew called family shows on the tour, where Mark, Tom, and Travis had their family and even their friends come out to hang out and watch the show. The backstage areas were flooded with kids, families, and friends.
Oh, they're very family-oriented. It definitely has something to do with the vibe that they want to create with having their kids around, traveling whenever possible, and allowing, you know, crew members to bring their families out to shows and things like that, because that's what it's all about. You know, why do all this hard work and you don't have anyone to share it with? You know?
It was really cool to see Travis as a dad on tour and watch him connect with his kids. I even saw Travis's son Landon performing alongside his dad on the stage while Blink-182 was playing. Out of all the shows we went to, by far my favorite one was Mountain View. The stage was a lot lower to the ground and was also just a smaller stage. We got much closer to the band.
Doug and Daniel and myself go up here and we get extra tickets from the band that we don't use. So I come up here and we scope it out and we decide on who we want to sit very close.
Yeah.
Cute right here with the red hair. She's cute. They could be good.
We got a minute.
We always do a all the way down, all the way back, so we can make sure that it's fair. Those two?
Maybe.
Oh, yeah, I agree. Hi, ladies.
Hi.
How are you?
We're good. How are you?
Good. Do you guys want to go sit in the front row?
Huh? What's that?
Is it just you two and your group?
Yeah, it's just us two.
Yeah? You want to go sit in the front?
The front?
The front, front. First.
The front, front? Like, legit front?
Legit front.
Sure, why?
Just because.
All right.
Ladies, how are we? Huh? Do you guys want to go sit in the front row?
Yes, please.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you talking?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Oh my god, that's so awesome!
So you're just gonna walk down there.
We're basically as close to the band as we were ever gonna get.
My name is Rob McShane. I direct the video for blink-182. For Blink, I've got four cameras. I've got a broadcast camera out front with a long lens. I've got a handheld camera in the pit, and I've got two what we call ice cube cameras, which are just little POVs that are on Travis, the drummer. But to me, this is my instrument. This is what I play. Those guys play the guitar and the bass and the drums, and I sit back here and play this along with what they're playing. It's really cool, actually, to sit in the back. Back here and do that for the kids, and the greatest feeling is when the crowd loves it. It's hard to wind down at the end of the night after the show because that's what it's all about.
Like an evolution. I mean, I've been listening to them since I was really young, and you know, they've grown up, they matured, and so have I, you know.
Coming back in this band, I think what I've learned to really follow my aspirations and really put myself out there and take these huge risks as an artist. But with Blink, I've learned to rein those back and also let the democracy of the band work.
And one of the things that we learned in Blink during the hiatus was that we are all very different people from one another, but the differences between us, which used to drive wedges between us, are actually the things that make Blink good when Blink is good.
I've been saving up for a car, and I just pretty much blew all my money buying these tickets right now. So that's how much they mean to me.
I heard them on, you know, the alternative stations, and I'm like, wow, this band's great. They're awesome, and they've just lasted, you know? It's like lasted all the way through to my kids now, and I've got an 8-year-old, too, at home that likes them.
You would think that Blink is like just pure like rebellion, and we're up there just taking the piss out of each other. But I think that the whole institution really creates a lot of good feelings for people, including myself.
I play today because I love walking out on stage and performing songs live. It's awesome. It's one of the best gratifying experiences I could ever hope for. All the other bands that have been on the tour have said your crew are the coolest crew that we've ever gotten to work with. And that, for me, is something that I'm really proud of because I think that we take a lot of time to cultivate an atmosphere on our tour of we're here to have a great time, we're also here to get it done and get it done in a good way.
Suddenly, it was all over. I looked out at the sold-out crowd in the Hollywood Bowl and realized that in a few hours, everyone was going to be going their separate ways. I was going back to school, Tony was starting a new tour, Meg was going back to New Hampshire, and John was going back to Maryland. Mark, Tom, and Travis were going back to their own homes, at least for a while. This world that I was a part of for 2 weeks was breaking apart forever. And I realized that there were no second chances. I couldn't shoot anything else, and I might not ever meet Mark, Tom, and Travis ever again. The experience was over. I just love being able to capture somebody's emotion and make somebody feel really strongly about something. I love working on something that everyone's so supportive and interested in while you're doing it, but then also when it's over with and done, you have something to show for what you did. The chance to be a professional filmmaker at the age of 19 has been a dream come true.